Hi everyone, welcome back to part 2 of our course. If you finished the beginner's part, congrats on making this far. I hope now you're comfortable with the basics. Because starting with this episode, we'll go deeper into our software. As we'll discover more complex functionalities, operations, and gestures that will allow you to create anything with vectors. We'll also cover even more design theory, like characterization, visual hierarchy, typography, layout design, and more. So let's get started. Let's start with a fresh canvas and add our sketch to a new layer. And lock it. Because I already know the elements of my illustration, I can go ahead and create and name all the layers that will help me keep my workflow organized. So I know I will have the lines, shadows, highlights, details in the face alongside details on the body. Finally, we got the background, which is not going to be a block color as we have seen until now. But it's going to nest all these details here that frame my character. Alright, let's start with the body. So make sure you have the correct layer selected. Now I got this peachy yellow gradient here that we created in episode 4. As a reminder, you can create it from scratch by tapping on one color, then gradient. Choose the second teardrop here, and then the second color, and back to gradient again. These teardrops control the colors that fade into each other, and moving them changes how the fade behaves. Okay, now with the pencil tool, I'm simply tracing the body shape. Wherever we have multiple overlapping layers, like for example, I know the hair will go on top, then the shape underneath does not have to be perfect. My mantra is, don't waste time on unnecessary polishing. We're going to create the face and the body separately, because this will help us control the color better, and give extra dimension to the illustration. So let's create the face with a simple oval. I also want my gradient to give meaning to the composition. So I'm going to move it in such a way that the yellow part is on upper left, because that is where the source of light comes from. This is not a decision I made now, I already placed my light source in the sketching phase. If you take a closer look, the shadows are cast by a source of light coming from this upper corner. And now we are just making sure that the colors reflect this fact. Time for the hair, which I'm going to color in with a black gradient. It's best to stay away from pure white or pure black in any of your designs. It just looks richer, more natural, and it's less jarring against other colors. Here I'm using the pen tool in combination with the node tool to refine my curves. If you're not familiar with these tools, then please watch episode 5. But if you are, stick around for some character design theory. In the sketching phase of your character, you can of course use a lot of references. You can even do a self-portrait, like I did. If you are creating something completely new, then it helps to answer a few questions. Who is your character? Do they have a gender, an age, an occupation? And depending on your project, you can even go deeper. What are their goals, their conflicts, what world do they live in? Based on all of that, you can decide on your character's pose, hair, facial expression, clothes, and accessories. Make sure that your stylistic decisions fully reflect who your character is. Shapes in themselves have their own language, like rounded shapes denote softness and approachability. But in the beginning, you can get fully inspired by references. Like in my case, I've created a self-portrait. But for a deeper dive into topic, you can also check our character design series. Let's quickly make the top. Looks a bit simple now, but no worries. We'll add more fun to it later. For now, let's move on to facial features, starting with the lips. I'm creating the upper and lower lip separately. The upper lip is going to be darker, simply because of where our light source comes from. Next, I'm making the cheeks and pupils with simple circles. Just create the one, make sure you hold down one finger to keep proportions. Then activate duplicate mode and hold one finger again to move the copy on a perfectly horizontal line. At this point, it helps to make the sketch transparent. I created this sketch in Procreate. And if you export it as PNG, I can actually have the sketch sit on top of my vectors. But it's getting a bit hard to see what I'm doing. Alright, now for the eyebrows, of course I can just trace around the shape like so. But a simpler and more elegant way to approach this is by using brush mode. Brush mode is one of the first new functionalities we're learning in this lesson. Personally, I use it quite a lot. I love the effect that it gives to my illustrations. So let's see why it's one of my favorite tools. You may have noticed the brush tool here in the toolbar. It's a freehand tool very similar to a pencil, with the benefit that the shape of my stroke can be virtually anything. It's not just a simple line or curve. Going to the style tab, we can see that we have a brush section here where I can choose my shape. We have 8 presets for you to get started. I can also change the stroke width, the smoothing, the color, but more importantly, I can change the shape of my stroke altogether. Here in the brush editing panel, we have this entire section that allows us to change the shape, the roundness, and angle of our brush. But I find it easiest to focus on the contour. This is the horizontal cross-section of my brush. It's a path that can be edited like any other in our software. I can add notes by tapping once. I can move them around like so. And I can also delete it with double tap. This means you can play around infinitely with brushes. Your imagination is the limit. So let's create a brush that resembles my eyebrow shape. This flat brush is a great start. Let's edit the left side so it's thicker. Then adjust the stroke width so it's closer in size. Great. Now I can draw this freehand. But the best part of our brush mode is that I can turn any path into a brush. So even if I have the pen tool at hand, if the brush mode is on, my path will look like this. Let's use this technique to finish one brow. And again for the other. And let's use it again for the eyelashes. If you notice, the eyelashes are thicker in the middle than at the ends. And this is yet another perfect use case for brushes. Let's switch to this one that looks like a diamond, but I will make some adjustments to it. Through trial and error, I know that this is more the type of shape that I need. Let's use a thinner brush for the individual lashes. Now for the nose and all these little expression lines, you can switch to a regular stroke. But I prefer to continue using this thin, stylized stroke at half the width.
Once you master the brush tool, you might find it hard to shake off. Of course, it depends on your personal style. But a brush stroke is an easy way to add more interest to your designs.
Let's check our progress so far. The illustration looks very flat at the moment. So it's time to fix that. I'm adding more dimension to the hair by drawing a few wavy strands here and there. But mainly where we have this line in the sketch here, where the hair is framing the face, and at the edges. Don't be afraid to color outside the lines. Hair is not a compact object, and a few wild strands will give it volume. As before, I'm using brush mode instead of a regular pad. Looks much better, doesn't it? But we're still missing something. So let's move on to one of the biggest lessons we'll learn today. Shadows and highlights. Let's revisit our sketch for a second. I have a pretty straightforward method when creating shadows. First, choose the position for my light source, which is here. If the light source is up, then I will have to create shadows under every area that sticks out or has volume. Like the nose will naturally have a nose-looking shadow, something like this. The hair will cast a shadow all around the face. The eyebrows will also create a shadow that looks something like this. Then there is a shadow under the eyes, and so on.
It's important you do light and shadow studies for this part. The biggest advice I can give you, practice is the best teacher.
Now back to our vectors, we need to simply follow the shape of my shadows. And I've got two important tips to share with you to make it look realistic. One, I use a blue to transparent gradient to trace my shapes. And then I adjust the gradient so the shadow is at its darkest at the top left, since it's the closest to the light, and gently face towards the bottom right. Two, we need to make the shadow blend more with the skin tone. So let's select the shadow and then go to blending modes, which are right here in the inspector.
Blend modes are used to determine how layers are blended, based on their hue, saturation, brightness, and combination of these components.
A great way to learn these powerful operations is through examples. So for shadows, a very typical blending mode is multiply. Pro tip, playing with opacity will give it that extra push. And now it just looks more seamlessly integrated with your character's skin tone and hair color.
The last shadow I'm going to add is a bit different than the rest. It's the shadow cast by the nose bridge. It starts from the tip and goes all the way to the eyebrow. In this case, the shadow is softer on the sides and darker at the bottom. Adding highlights will take on the same process, but we'll use a different blending mode instead. So let's add the highlights, which will naturally be here, on the tip of the nose. Then let's follow the same technique, select the highlights, and then go to blending modes. Once here, let's choose overlay. Again, opacity is our friend. Let's use it to our advantage. Easy, right?
After all this light and shadow work, let's focus on clothes and the background. I hope you remember the masking and the Boolean operations. But if not, let's brush up on this knowledge.
An easy way to add a pattern to her top is by creating a simple wavy shape. Let's duplicate it a few times. Make sure it goes all the way up. Now select everything and hit mask. We added that extra bit of fun in just a few seconds. And I'm going to add all these background elements with tools you have seen before, so we'll just go faster through it. One thing I want to stress is that here, to create these holes in the sleeve, I can use a Boolean operator, namely subtract. You probably heard it a million times until now, but it's just one of those functions that come in handy a lot. I want to end the lesson by circling back to designing a character. I did not add these leaves here by chance. Since this is my self-portrait, I just ask myself what elements would define me as a person. Plants were a no-brainer. My bedroom is slowly turning into a jungle. So I want to bring that aspect into my illustration. Ultimately, make sure you think of what makes your character themselves and use your imagination to inject that into your piece.
Hope you enjoyed today's lesson. This is the final artwork. What do you guys think? Does she look like me? The sketch is down below if you want to use it. But it's better if you create your own. Tune in for our next episode. We'll design super fun sticker pack together. I'll see you there.